According to CBS News, the worst bee die-off in history is happening right now. As a permaculture urbanist, I thought it's kind of my duty to delve into what a bee die-off would really mean for us, whether we even know why it's happening in the first place, and what cities can do about it. Welcome to Edenicity, Best Practices for Sustainably Abundant Cities. Okay, according to CBS, millions of bees have died this year already. One of the nation's top beekeepers was quoted as saying, "The data is showing us that this is the worst bee loss in recorded history." Entomologist Julia Rangel of Texas A&M said that while there's no certain answer, some possible explanations include changing habitats and weather patterns. And I'll add quite a few more in a moment. Bees make honey and pollinate 75% of fruits, nuts, and vegetables grown in the U.S. And if this trend continues, it'll change the way we consume food in the United States. If we lose 80% of our bees every year, the industry cannot survive, which means they cannot pollinate at the scale that we need to produce food in the United States. He goes on to give some examples, but I'll give quite a few more detailed examples in a moment. But the most immediate problem is that there's no almond crop without honeybees, and indeed it was the almond crop where this problem turned up over the last 8 months. One beekeeper reported a 95% loss of bees just over the last few weeks. University labs are scrambling to fill in the gaps in research caused by U.S. Department of Agriculture cuts in recent weeks, so the lab work isn't even done to have anything close to a definitive answer on this. But the most recent losses have already been upward of 60% of honeybee colonies, with total financial losses of $139 million, and Cornell scientists echoing the general sentiment that this could be the worst honeybee loss in U.S. history. These numbers compound earlier losses of 70 to 100% of many beekeepers over the past 12 months. So a lot is happening fast. We don't yet know what's going on, but here's what that could mean for us. This is an older paper, but I think it very nicely summarizes the scope of the services that bees provide for people. And I'm pulling my figures from this paper. Let's have a look. Without bees, we would be looking at 90% fewer apples, almonds, avocados, beans for goodness sakes, blueberries, cherries, cranberries, onions, broccoli, carrots, squash, sunflower. Now, I'm kind of panicking at these figures because I'm a vegan, and these are essential sources of nutrition, especially for vegans. But honestly, these are major sources of nutrition for anybody. Even if you're on the Atkins diet, you should be eating lots of greens such as broccoli and good vegetable fats from avocados and sunflower seeds, which are really good sources of vitamin E. Now, some plants are less affected by this. Soy, peanuts, grapes, and citrus, as well as peaches, are partly pollinated by bees, so there would be a reduction of 5% of those crops and others. Weirdly enough, the bee colony collapses will have no effect on corn, wheat, rice, peppers, potatoes, tomatoes, and yams. That's good news for people with any diet, because these foods provide a lot of the calories as well as protein through animal feed for our most basic macros. So the bottom line is that we're not looking at starvation in terms of calories and protein, but we are looking at significantly more expensive nutrition. But why are colonies collapsing? Again, we don't fully know yet. There are many possible causes, and it could be a combination. And based on the known factors, there are some best practices that we'll get into in a moment. According to the Bee Conservancy, there are five primary threats to pollinators. There's habitat loss with the expansion of industrial agriculture and human development. Habitats have dwindled, fragmented, or disappeared completely. And this includes natural spaces containing important forage and nesting sites for pollinators, including bees. And I briefly touched on this in an earlier episode. The second cause is climate change, and I'll add a nuance to that in a moment. Changing climate conditions have caused dramatic shifts in the temperatures, causing flowering plants to grow farther north and leave pollinator populations behind. Extreme weather patterns and events are disrupting ecosystems all over the world, making it hard for native bees to find the food and safe haven they need. Now, the effect on native bees, as opposed to honeybees, which are trucked around to pollinate commercial crops, is that their parasites may move on to honeybees, and also the native bees themselves contribute a lot of pollination to many crops. For example, only 60% of the pollination of alfalfa and hayseed is by honeybees. The rest is by any of thousands of additional species of native bees. The third cause is chemical pesticides, including neonicotinoids, which are a very effective pest control known to many home and market gardeners who have long used nicotine from tobacco as a pesticide. The problem is that they are too good at wiping out insects, including pollinators such as honeybees. The fourth cause is invasive plant species, which may outcompete native species and overtake local ecosystems, which can result in a loss of food forage for local bees whose diets have evolved to feed on local plant life. So again, this would be the native non-honeybee pollinators. And the problem is that as invasives take over, they may bloom in different seasons than the native species. This may create a shortage of forage for the bees for part of the year. Then finally, as I mentioned earlier, diseases and parasites, which in an ecological view are just doing their job of removing stressed plants and animals. The problem is when all of the animals are stressed, as is often the case with bees being trucked around the country and enduring habitat loss, climate change, chemical pesticides, and invasive plant species, all of the bees are stressed. So they much more easily fall prey to varroa mites, as well as German yellow jackets and various fungi. Now, the Bee Conservancy does provide hints for individuals to do something about these problems, and here's what home gardeners can do to help the bees. The first is to be active in trying to preserve bee habitats, replacing lawns with pocket wildflower meadows, native gardens, and flowering lawn alternatives, avoiding synthetic pesticides by building a sustainable, balanced ecosystem that fosters beneficial populations, choose bee-friendly plants, and they give several examples here, maintain some bare patches of soil for bees to nest, as more than 70% of the world's 20,000 bee species, including bumblebees, are ground-dwelling. I've got a crazy story about that. I was mowing once with a scythe on my market garden when I heard this strange buzzing. I thought it was motorcycles in the distance, but it turned out to be a swarm of bees landing on me, and they got on my glasses, and they were in my hair and up and down my arms, but they hadn't stung me yet. Looking down, I realized I was standing practically on their nest. You know, they had me. I realized that running around, flapping my arms, and freaking out and panicking would just rile them up. So I just took a step back. And as I did, I noticed that several of them lifted off of me. So I took another step back, and then several more lifted off of me. And then another step, a few more lifted off of my glasses. Gradually, they all lifted off of me, and I got away without being stung. But for the rest of the summer, I couldn't get within 5 paces of that nest without them coming out and swarming angrily around me. So they remember. You can also plant trees that bloom in a wide range of seasons, and it really helps if the trees are native. In Ohio, I especially like serviceberries, juneberries, call them what you will. They're delicious and spice bush. And in the fall, when you're cutting your garden back, leave some stems open for bees to nest inside. Learn more. They provide some learning resources, volunteer. Engage in community science, they give some hints, and again, take action. So lots of helpful hints there. But hey, this is Edenicity, so let's look at what can be done at the scale of cities. And let's break this down by problem. First is habitat loss. This is really big. We've occupied half the world and replaced layered ecosystems with single-layered agriculture and mostly single-layered housing, as well as other uses. And this has had the effect of wiping out half of the living biomass on Earth. As I've explained in detail in other episodes, the number one thing we can do in cities is go car-free, which frees up anywhere from 45 to 75% of the surface area of cities for other uses. If those other uses are mainly layered food gardens with native nectar plants, we can have much more robust pollination right there in the city, much higher combined yields, again, due to the layering, than open field agriculture. And by providing significant amounts of food within the city, we can unburden large landscapes for restoration. Second, climate change. And again, going car-free reduces our fossil fuel use in the transportation sector by a factor of 10. And if we focus on multifamily housing, that is to say apartments, brownstones, townhouses, and the like, we can electrify with solar and wind energy on site. Those are mitigations. Those reduce the causes of climate change. But we can also adapt to climate stresses by rehydrating landscapes. The excellent YouTube channel Water Stories has pointed out that 87% of the world's wetlands have been drained. By rehydrating cities along the lines of what they do on that channel and what we do in permaculture, many cities can end the cycle of floods and droughts that has plagued them since they were dried out for development, even with the added stress of climate change, as has been shown again and again in Australia. See links below for examples. Reducing pollution, again, going car-free. So this is an example of interactive diversity, where one design choice interacts with the overall system in many different ways, providing many positive effects. To remove the risk of pesticides, cities need to stop spraying as much as they do. I know in Columbus, in a smaller town in Texas that I lived, in the summertime, trucks would come around at night, fogging the air with insecticide intended to wipe out mosquitoes. The problem with this is that a month down the road, you don't hear any songbirds because a major food source of theirs has been removed. The sprays don't just wipe out mosquitoes. They wipe out a whole broad swath of insects, including, in all likelihood, pollinators, at least within city limits. As an alternative, I've written neighborhood grants in Bloomington, Indiana, for example, for annual cleanups where we remove the many old tires that are lying around in people's backyards, collecting rainwater and acting as mosquito breeding grounds throughout the summer. Strangely enough, rehydrating the landscape does not increase the mosquito population in the way that you would think, because where natural drainage into permanent ponds becomes a permanent feature of the landscape, the ponds self-stock with amphibians and can be additionally stocked with fish to control the mosquito population. In fact, I've put a link in the description below to a Purdue Extension study that showed that well-stocked ponds alone can reduce mosquito populations by up to 90%, which is sort of the best of both worlds. More insects, including more pollinators, but far fewer mosquitoes due to a much more ecologically balanced, designed landscape. And then as far as the diseases and parasites go, the main solution is to de-stress the bees as much as possible by keeping them on site, not trucking them all over the country, and restoring flowering meadow and other natural forage and pollen sources for the off seasons. Of course, a really good permaculture design would be to provide as many viable flowering food sources to cover all of those seasons for the city bees, and then make sure to provide supporting tree species such as legume trees that fix nitrogen, that bloom at times that fill in whatever gaps may exist. Now, if you're new to Edenicity, you can watch this video to learn a little bit more about it. Download the Edenicity land use concept, which in a kind of a blocky schematic way shows you how the various pieces of Edenicity would fit together. And no, it doesn't have to be rectangular. It's just a lot easier to draw. And thanks as always to the wonderful patrons for making this work possible. Take care, be green, see you next time.